sister. Know the water's sweet, but blood is thicker. Oh, if the sky comes falling down for you, there's nothing in this world I wouldn't do. Hey, brother, do you still believe?
Hello, hi everyone. A very good afternoon again. Welcome again to our Marketing Institute of Singapore Lunchtime webinar. And we are going into our 21st Lunchtime webinar. Wow, 21st, 21 time, right? Huh? So this is our 21st sessions. So yeah, we've come a long way, like what we said. We will be here with you till the end of our lockdown, which will be happening on the 2nd of June. Our last session will be on the 30th of May. But however, I think to the surprise of many Singaporeans yesterday, when the government announced the phases in terms of lockdown, it's not a 100% lockdown that we're looking at. We're looking at perhaps only about a third or even less than one third of you getting into the community, going into your workplace. Pretty much will still be done from home. Okay, you'll still be doing a lot of things from home itself. So let us consider, see if we should decide to actually continue our webinar, lunchtime webinar, throughout the lockdown to even extend it beyond May. So here is where I need a bit of response from you, our attendees itself. Now, if you want us to continue right up to perhaps the first week of June, do let us know, okay? So depends on you, in fact, the attendees itself to our webinar. Or on our Facebook itself. Let us know if you want us to extend to the first week of June itself to continue to actually support you, to keep you company throughout our lockdown or beyond our lockdown itself. So good thing that our Singapore government has actually announced and giving in three phases on our release in terms of our lockdown itself. So the first phase is going to take place on the 2nd of June. I don't know, they were talking about the new normal, all right? You heard our government talking about new norm. So what is the new norm? Normal is never going to be the normal. Business will not be as usual again. If you expect things to come back to what it used to be pre-COVID, it's not going to happen, okay? So let's hope it will not affect us too much. So the questions in our mind is, what is the new norm? Okay, so today, in fact, we're very glad to actually have a speaker all the way from Manila to join us to speak in today's webinar session, and it's none other than Dr. Donald Lim. All right, the topic today will be building business resiliency during COVID-19. Okay, so now, Donald, I'll tell you more about him, how I come to know Dr. Donald itself. Interesting person. It's someone that I said, you know, over the past 2 years of my engagement has actually left a very deep impression on me itself. And ever since then, Donald's name has been always revolving whenever I'm looking for someone to actually share the experience. Now, he is quite young, he's not that old, but he comes with a wealth of experience. Both at the management level and at the strategic thinking level itself. Okay, let's go on to our Facebook, yeah? So, now, MIs, we are doing our very bit in terms of supporting home SG to stay at home during this lockdown period, and that's why we come up with this initiative. Now, if you appreciate our initiative, can you just help us? Go on to your Facebook or log on to your like and share, okay? Just click on your like and share. Help us to spread the word of MIs, all right, to your friends, to your peer, to your community, so that more people can benefit from our speakers like Dr. Donald, all right? So, yeah, you can do it right now or you can do it later, no problem, okay? Now, we are also going on live, Facebook Live, and on YouTube Live. Now, just in case you miss out on any of our sessions, please, you can always revisit them again over our YouTube and our Facebook. Okay. We are happy to announce that this is our third series, which will be approaching the midway through our third series itself. So as you can see, Dr. Donald Lim. Yeah, yesterday we have Dr. Ang Peng Hua. Interesting. being the chair and the vice president of the CASE, the Consumer Association of Singapore, and the Advertising Authority Standard Board itself. Well, the thing that he mentioned to me, I think, yeah, it's something that we can be looking at, you know, especially engaging the media with influencer. Now, tomorrow, of course, you can see two other speakers for this third series will be Mr. Earl Allens and Mr. Balvik. All right, so the topic to be covered tomorrow will be the importance of design thinking. And on the 22nd will be the leadership guide to building a strategic brand narrative. Okay, so now, like what we said, you know, on the 27th, I think I did touch on this. Can we have the slide on the 27th itself? Where MIS will be collaborating with the Asia Marketing Federation. You have that slide. Can I have the next slide, please? Yes, there we have it. Okay. Now, 27th of May, it's where we call it the Asia Marketing Day. Now, this is done in collaboration, MIS, together with the Asia Marketing Federation folks. Okay. Now, MIS, we're part of the Asia Marketing Federation, which comprises of 17 countries and region. Now, as you can see, we will be celebrating the father of modern marketing, Professor Philip Kotler's birthday. On that day itself, he'll be celebrating his 89th birthday. All right, and one of our keynote speaker will be Mr. Hamawan Kartojaya, which is the founder of the Asia Marketing Federation. Now, as you can see, it's backed and supported by all the 17 countries and region among the Asian Marketing Federation members, Asia Marketing Federation members. We'll be having the whole day, in fact, practically the whole day, from 10:30 a.m. right down to 4 p.m. Singapore time, yeah? So whole day we'll be having webinar sessions. Do find out more, which we'll be sharing with you tomorrow on the different time zone, different caucus. We'll be having the East, Northeast caucus early part of the day, mid part of the day, the ASEAN caucus, and ending part of the day, the South caucus, the South Asia caucus itself. Okay, so do find out more on some of the topics, which I find them very, very relevant. Now, it's good to actually hear from our neighboring countries or among our Asia marketing folks on what to expect or what can we do in terms of post-COVID itself. So it's a session that I will not miss on the 27th of May, which will be happening at 10:30. Our room will be open at 10, you know, for you to settle in comfortably from your home. So join us, okay? And that's where, wow, the meeting of the great minds, in the area of marketing, okay? So this is where, if I were you, I'll lock in into my schedule, okay? Now, of course, I've been talking about our executive development program. This is where I've been always encouraging my friends, including our staff from MIS, from some of the schools, or some of my peers itself. What are you doing at home during this period of time? If you're watching Korean drama, if you're watching, if you're playing online games, I think maybe you would like to rethink about how should you better make use of your time. Huh? So that's where you can actually join our executive development program itself, where we have more than 120 over courses online. We're making it online right now via Zoom to deliver the course to you so that you can increase your skill set. So that post-COVID itself, you emerge as a stronger person that the organizations will need you. Otherwise, you probably will find yourself out of job. Okay, so as we know, I think for last month itself, there are about 8,000 over companies in Singapore that shut down, declare bankrupt or close off their business, shut down their business and things like that. So yes, what is the new norm? This may be part of the new norm where you're seeing a lot of transformation in terms of business and industry. Now, if you notice, we are the winner of the HRM Asia Award for the best corporate training provider. And it has been going on for the past 5 years. So 5 years in a row, we got that award. So that tells you about the quality of our executive training program. Okay, let's go on. Next, I need to do this fast because I want Donna to come aboard soon. Okay, Advanced Diploma in Digital Marketing. Get yourself certified to be a digital marketer through our Advanced Diploma in Digital Marketing. Otherwise, please don't just call yourself a digital marketer because you know Facebook, LinkedIn, and that's it. You know? So there are more to it. Search engine optimization, search engine management, Google Analytics. So much more in order to call yourself a digital marketer. So in order to get yourself certified as a digital marketer, please take on an academic qualifications so that you can present yourself, hey, you know what? I'm not just a digital marketer by self-proclaim, but rather I'm academically qualified, okay? So pick up the advanced diploma in digital marketing. It's not that expensive, guys. We are making it very easy and value for money for you. And besides, you can pay it in installment, okay? Installments, okay, a couple of installments anyway, 3 or 4 months, if I'm not wrong. So, MIS, as you know, we are not for profit. We are not there to generate profit. We are there to help the industry. So this is one of the courses which I will highly, highly, highly recommend for those people that you think you'll probably be out of job very soon, or you are already out of job right now. You are already jobless. Take this time to upgrade yourself, okay? You know, because moving on, a lot of companies will be moving onto digital platform. I've spoken to a couple of digital marketing agencies, and they were saying that business is booming for them right now. So yeah, that tells you volume, right? You should pick up our advanced diploma in digital marketing offered by our Marketing Institute of Singapore Business School. Okay, and of course, our two other diplomas, our diploma in business, can I have the previous slide? Diploma in business and diploma in sales and marketing, which we have been conducting for the past 30 years. Okay, so yeah, if you have, like what I said, friends, niece, nephew, sons, daughters, or friends of your son, daughters, advise them to take on education right now, okay? All right, or if you are doing another diploma or even in IT right now, I think it's good for you to pick up a diploma, especially you probably graduate earlier than your peers who are in the polytechnic, okay? All right, so the telephone numbers out there, please reach out to us, okay? Let's go on to the next slide. Our membership. Now it's coming to the end, yeah? Okay, all right, clock is ticking. We are only offering right up to the end of this month in terms of membership. Yeah, the previous slide. So if you have not signed up for our associate members or our international associate members for those that are coming out of Singapore itself, please fill up the form right now and sign up, okay? Reason being because there are a lot of values being our members besides all the discount that you will be getting for joining us in our course. It's also about joining the community, okay, of marketers in Singapore. So as you know, we are the longest serving associations that represent Singapore in the area of marketing. So it's good to actually have your membership, to have you link up with us via our membership, okay? So that you can in fact use that title, AMIS, Associate Members of Marketing Institute of Singapore, AMMIS, okay? All right, or International Associate Members, all right, in presenting your credentials to your would-be employers, okay? All right, so join us as a member and find out how we can enjoy further discount. Let's get on to the next slide, please. Now, we are doing our mass donation. We've been doing that for the past 3 weeks to a month, asking you to help us in our donation drive. We still need more to come. In fact, this is where you can scan the QR code itself. Now, we are working with the Philippine Marketing Association and the past president, which is Gwen, on this. I think when you're online right now, I can see your name here. Singapore government, they are doing a great job. I need to get an award, like what I said. Please, someone just inform our local government. I've been saying good things about them. They have been providing us with our third mask right now, right? So we are okay. Singapore, we are safe. Singaporean, as long as you put on the mask, you get out of your house with the social distancing and things like that, you'll probably be very, very safe. But I couldn't say the same for our folks from the neighboring countries, such as in Philippines. Not all of them actually get full of a mask. That is the basic equipment or device or basic thing that actually shield you from the COVID-19. All right, so help us in this donation drive. Like what I said, this donation drive is not going to Singaporean. We are well taken care of in that area itself. So it's going to our neighboring country. So the very first country that we're going to is Philippine Manila. Okay, so please help us. It's just $20, folks. We're not asking very much for a box of 50 ma. Okay, so lock on to that. If not, otherwise, WhatsApp the two numbers that are being flashed on the screen right now. WhatsApp them and then ask them how can you actually join us in our mass donation drive. Okay, let's look beyond Singapore. We are a global citizens. Okay, right. Now, today, okay, I've come to, I've done my thing as the president of the Marketing Institute of Singapore. And of course, today, Dr. Donald Patrick Lim. Wow. I met him 2 years ago. In fact, way before 2 years ago, when I visited Philippines. It was in one of their conference. I tell you, I love the things that Philippine Marketing Association are doing. You know, they are always very, very creative when it comes to conference. And 2 years ago, they named the conference the what? The after a series of show. What? Okay. I was just mentioning to Donald. Oh, the Game of Thrones. Yes. And last year, in fact, they said the greatest something. Always named after a popular TV series or a movie itself. Basically, the greatest show on earth, I think, if I'm not wrong, yeah, last year. So I am always intrigued by how our Filipinos counterpart are able to make the conference very successful, very colorful with new themes, new ways of engaging the audience. So it's during that time where I actually met Dr. Donald Patrick Lim, young guy, very innovative, very, very bright. I was telling my staff, he's in fact one of the brightest I've ever met, okay, over the past few years. And that's why he left a very deep impression on me. And then in our Asia Marketing Summit in Singapore, where MIS Marketing Institute of Singapore hosted, we invited him to be our keynote speaker to talk. And there we have it, you know, we learn even more from him. All right, let me tell you more about the accolades of Donald Patrick Lim right now, okay? Dr. Donald Patrick Lim. He's currently the Chief Operating Officer of Ditto CME. Okay, which is the third telco in Philippines right now, all right? And he's also the Chief Innovation Officer of Udenna Corporation, which is a conglomerate, all right? So prior to his current role, he served in various leadership capacities in the media, advertising, and digital spaces, okay? Having been the country CEO of Dentsu Aegis Philippines, he has also been the Chief Digital Officer of ABS-CBN Corporation, okay? TV channels itself. And also the Managing Director of MRM Manila and the CEO of Yehey Corporations and Media Context Manila. Now, Dr. Donald Lim completed his MBA with distinction from Murdoch Universities, as well as his doctorate in business admin from the University of Phoenix. On top of this, he also holds a diploma in interior decorating. Colorful, right, this guy? interior decorating. A diploma in executive management and a diploma in hotel and restaurant management. Now, I just get to know that he was also an entrepreneur. He's also an entrepreneur. He actually opened some restaurant business currently in the Philippines. Now, Dr. Donald Lim has a long list of accolades with tremendous accomplishment. And we're just sharing some of his milestones and highlights. So currently, Dr. Donald also teaches, he finds time to teach, right, in e-marketing at the Graduate School of LaSalle, the LaSalle Universities, and the IMC program at the Universities of Asia and the Pacific, and advanced marketing and advanced strategic management for doctorate program at San Beda Universities, one of the top universities in Philippines, okay? He was also an adjunct professor in the Asia Institute of Management and Bradford Universities. And also he's the youngest to serve as the president of the Philippine Marketing Associations, which shows the biggest gathering of marketing professionals in Philippines. See what I mean? Youngest, and he looks very young. and with his accolades and accomplishment, you'd probably be looking at someone probably at the age of 60 or what, but no, he's not, okay? Let's welcome Donald Patrick Lim into the room right now. Yeah. Okay.
Hi, Roger.
Now you realize something that's very similar with Donald. Remember the first time when I met you, Donald, you said, hey, both of us looks the same. Our dress code will always be in black jackets, black black pants, boots, or whatever.
Yes, okay. That's our trademark. That's marketing, right? Consistency.
Yeah, that's true. No? Okay, so we got a lot of folks today to learn from you on building business resiliency during COVID-19. As we know, as I was talking about, the new norm will never be the same as before. Yeah. So really, business transform and how to really stay on in business. I think that's the mind of a lot of Singaporean businessmen, including some of them from the Asia itself, some of the management, what to do. You know, there are a lot of question marks right now. Everyone is saying a lot of things, but what really is the thing that we should pick up and how should we address that? Quite frankly, if you ask me, do I have an answer for that? No. Okay. Mm-hmm. So that's why I try to gather feedback and things like that and try to you know, perhaps to actually bring on great speakers like you to actually offer another perspective from a more regional or even in Philippines itself. What are you doing or what are you planning as a top management in the conglomerate, especially with the third telco in Philippines itself? So here's where we need to hear and learn from you. So take it on, Donald Patrick.
Thank you. Thank you, Roger. And to all my friends in the AMF, thank you for having me. It's always a pleasure to be speaking in front of our marketing brothers and sisters in the ASEAN and in Asia. I was telling Roger, I was there 2 years ago in Singapore in the AMF meeting. And again, very interesting times right now as we are faced with this COVID virus that is affecting all of us around the world. So let me just give everyone a quick background. So what I will do, for the past 60 days, the Philippines has been under quarantine and we are on lockdown. So I think in various countries around Asia, we all have our different rules in our local government units implementing different sorts of quarantine measures. So, but I think the Philippines is one of the strictest in terms of the quarantine. And we're already on our 60th days, 2 months in already. We're going to our third month. Hopefully by the end of the third month, we will be back to normal. Well, what maybe the new normal. And we're seeing already a lot of effects in our economy. And that is why I think this week was what they call a modified quarantine, wherein some businesses are now allowed to open at the 50% capacity. So I will take you through my slides. First is an idea on what this creature is, COVID, what we have learned. I've gotten some insights from a lot of our consultant friends, which I will be sharing with you. Moving forward, what Roger was saying, no one has any crystal ball. We actually don't know what's going to happen, but we are looking as marketing people. We know what the trends are. So hopefully, let's take advantage of all of these trends that we have observed, and hopefully we can actually take advantage of this as once everything is open, back to business, and hopefully we are able to adjust from that. And I will end with something hopefully that would inspire us and provide more optimism because I know a lot of our businesses are now being challenged given this new scenario, business scenario. I will be very quick with my slides. I will talk for around 35 to 40 minutes and then I will open the floor for question and answer. So just a brief background. I'm part of the Udenna Corporation. We are a company of companies. It's a conglomerate. We have around 100 companies under our fold. Our flagship product is Phoenix, which is a gasoline and LPG company. We have schools like Enderon. We own Wendy's and Conti's here in the country. We're the upcoming third telco. And we also have a shipping line. We have gaming and tourism hotels. And we have massive developments down south and north, actually, around the country. So it's a massive conglomerate where we have more than 100 companies under it. So I have a bigger view across our group. So let me start my presentation with a phrase that's coined by Rahm Emanuel. He was the former mayor of Chicago. And he said, you know, you never let a serious crisis go to waste. And what I mean by that is that it's an opportunity to do things you think you could not do before. So what Rahm Emanuel is saying is that I know that in many cases, during our normal business as usual, we would want to execute a lot of things, a lot of ideas, but we are always kept busy with our day-to-day. This pandemic actually gives us no more excuse because most of us are not doing any business. We're on lockdown, sales are down. It might be also an opportune time for us to relook at how we can do things. Maybe something that is burning at the back of our heads, what we want to do, what we want to experiment. This may be the best time to do it. And I'll show you a lot of examples of that later on. If you look at the infections, even leading towards today, what is very interesting was that if you look at the US being the most infected, and then of course after that, China, Italy, and some parts of Europe, Africa actually has the least number of infections. So this is actually encouraging, but at the same time alarming, because we don't know if they do not have testing that is happening, or are they really safe? Hopefully they're safe. So which means that once all of this, every country was able to, if we're able to flatten the curve, then we will be, at least Africa will be the first to actually research and start off with all of these trade and economics. If not, however, then there's going to be another forced recession because Africa also has a very strong hold on the global consumption. So Africa is a big question mark across all. So what we're all experiencing right now is a circumstance. So it's a challenge like many of us have never seen before. The circumstances are taking us beyond our knowledge and capabilities. There's an avalanche of information, hard to know what is correct. So we are seeing a lot of news, fake news, what is happening. We don't even know what is really happening based on our social media feeds. But right now, we don't know what is correct, right? So currently for us, we have competing priorities, keeping people healthy. But at the same time, we want to keep our business going. So we want to keep our stores open, but we're also scared for our people. So that's something that we always have to keep in mind. It's a highly dynamic situation. It changes by the minute. We want to plan for a week, 2 weeks from now. But what we know is that everything is not sure. The end point is not at all clear. And there are high uncertainty, high stakes. But the decisions have to be made under stress in real time. So if you think that is happening with you, let me tell you now, that is also happening with everyone else. So the leadership challenge for all of us as business leaders and as marketing leaders is that what do we do when no one knows what to do? What do we do with a situation this complex? What do we do when things are moving this fast? And all of us, we have to figure it out in real time under considerable stress. This is our new COVID-19 normal for a temporary but indefinite period. So what I mean here is that in essence, that's a challenge for all of us. Not maybe if you are asking this question for yourself, this is a question actually everyone is asking themselves. And if you think about it, there's no book that would give you the answer to this because you actually throw the book out the window, there are new rules are in play and everyone is still thinking what to do and how to make their pivot from this situation. If you look at April 30, we've seen also our share. Singapore was down, then actually surged up. We've seen also how Indonesia is very challenged, and also, of course, us, the Philippines. Today, we've reached, I think, 12,000 already. So we're slowly climbing, but very well managed. And I think the Philippines is one of the strictest in terms of quarantine measures. So we have our military and the police out in the streets. And if you are caught without a quarantine pass, they will actually send you back to your home, or at worst, they can even put you in prison. No? So it's very strict here. And that's why we're hoping to curb the infections here in our country. And we've seen already our ASEAN neighbors, very interesting, about Myanmar, Cambodia, Laos, they have very, and Vietnam actually, have already flattened their own curves. No? So hopefully us, the more developed ones could also follow and hopefully do our share in flattening the curve for the sake of our business. So just this is just a very simple graph to share with you that we are in this trajectory. No? And then US, China, Italy have actually been the top three worldwide in terms of having the most number of infections. And let me just give everyone a perspective. I got this from a briefing from the Boston Consulting Group. If you look at the history of pandemics this century, no, the Spanish flu and the Asian flu were the two biggest ones. Of course, the Spanish flu, straight after World War I, they infected 25 million. And then, of course, closer to our lifetime would be SARS, the swine flu, and COVID-19. The Spanish flu was very fatal because if you look at it, the fatality was 10%. So 10% of those infected actually died. But of course, the medical advancements there was still very low that time. SARS was also had a very high fatality rate, so it's at 10%. COVID-19, this is a 2 to 4%, but most likely this would go down to around 1%. No? Currently, I think COVID is now at 200,000 in terms of deaths around the world. No? US, of course, leading the charge there. However, the difference is the contagiousness. So while the Spanish flu has a contagiousness, what they call the RO, the RO, contagiousness ratio of 2, the COVID most likely would be the same as SARS or even higher because of the asymptomatic nature of the disease. So in many cases, for example, for families here in the Philippines, we have an average household number of 5. A person would be going out and would be taking in groceries. And then when the father gets home after buying, he wouldn't know he was infected until 2 weeks after, and he would have infected 4 other people. So the contagiousness is very high, but at least on the good side, the fatality rate is a bit lower than what would be the versus other pandemics. So there are 3 types of economic contractions. I'm sure all of you have heard of this already. So it's the V shape, the U shape, and the L shape. So it's everyone's guess where we are. This is done by Harvard Business Review, and it's talking about pandemics and the what we call the economic contractions or the recessions. The V-shape is what they call a classic economic shock, where growth eventually rebounds. Maybe this would be if you have a typhoon or a tsunami, it affects a certain part of a country. You have a small decline, and it would just go back to normal in that simple straight line trajectory. You would just have a small dip. So that's a V-shape. There's what you call a U-shape, where everything gets extended. So there will be permanent loss of output after the initial shock. So here you're looking at a GDP level of 120. Now it's below 120 because of U-shape. It's an extended period. The L-shape would mean there's a real structural damage and the growth trajectory has changed. This is longer lasting and there is a more permanent effect towards the economy and the structural parts of the economy. Like some sectors of the business will not be able to thrive after this pandemic. So that's what you call the L-shape. So where are we really? So the expectations for COVID-19 is that we are at an extended V curve with a potential for U. So I think most countries right now are doing a worst case scenario at a U level. So what does it mean? If it's a V to a U, the virus property will stay or worsen. No? There will be some mitigation measures that are slow and unsuccessful. So what will happen is that the virus would stay for a much longer period. What we're looking on also is that for government, the policy response is too late and too timid. So the market confidence and household will actually collapse in terms of confidence, like the government is not doing well in terms of addressing that concern. If you look at the crisis length, it would be around 3 to 6 months. I think optimistically, it would be around 6 months. So that's something we should be start planning for starting March. You know? And I'll discuss this more later on. The impacts on 1.7 is for the Philippines. I think most of us will be looking at a flat economic growth across the different Asian countries. Social impact would be around 0.6 to 1% of the population. So quite high. You know? If you look at it, the global recession is all but guaranteed. US is heavily hit. way tougher than the 2008-2009 financial crisis of their time. We're looking at the shock risk towards a U-shaped contraction. So the battle to avoid a recession is lost, but the battle for the extent is not yet lost. So here, if you look at the BCG analysis, in many cases, the critical care patients have gone up tremendously. We experienced that here in the Philippines, no? And the healthcare wasn't able to adjust and adapt. So there's what you call the red part, where the demand for healthcare was way up than the supply. In fact, in the Philippines, we're seeing so many people asking, a lot of the hospitals are saying, we cannot take any more patients because we're full. But after some time, of course, the healthcare system would be able to adjust. And also people would, of course, some infected would have passed on, some would become healthier. So then you will have this split already, that that the healthcare would be able to adapt and the critical care patients would go down. And then you would see, of course, at what they call a restart stage. Hopefully this would be the end of the quarantine period for most of us, and we will be able to do business back to normal. So that is the question for all of us, in a way, because if you look at it, if I remove just the health and look at the economic scenario, this would be what they call the flattened phase, the dip. Most of us experience this, no? These are the, this is the deep, how deep it is and how long is that this dip. So we're already looking at March and April on our side of the country. So in the Philippines, March, April, May is this. Hopefully we get to go up and release our quarantine by mid-June. And then that would be the fight phase. So in the fight phase, hopefully things would have would be moving up all the way. And then what they're saying is that the future phase would be when the vaccine is there or when people have really confidence going out already. Some industries would be able to adjust. Some would have permanent damage, like, for example, tourism. So here we're looking at, here currently most of us are in this scenario, still in the flattened, unless the quarantine has been lifted in your country, then you would most likely be experiencing in the fight phase already. So if you look at, for example, our company, Udenna, because we cut across different industries, so we actually assess our companies, looking at what is the impact on the crisis. Our convenience stores, we have Family Mart. We own the Family Mart franchise here. Our goods and logistics, so like what I've said earlier, we have a shipping company, people logistics, we have a manpower company. These may have a lower impact, but we have a big impact on our gaming and tourism. For example, we own hotels. Our restaurant business is a bit hit. Also, our Phoenix Petroleum, our gasoline is also hit. So we are basing our future planning based across this matrix. And why is that? When people talk about contractions, in the most simplistic sense, it's all about having what they call a demand shock and a supply shock. A demand shock means that, for example, for our petroleum business, when our president said no more people going out, then the people are just not, you know, leaving their houses with their cars. The gasoline just actually, people just stop going out and getting their gas. So in that sense, the next day when we woke up, all our Phoenix gasoline outlets have no more people there gassing up. So that was a demand shock. We found ourselves having too much supply. So that leads to the second one, which is a supply shock. So we have too much oil, too much gasoline. And what is happening right now is that we have a lot of gasoline on our barges, on our supply, on our platforms, and we can't get them going off the market. So we have what is called a supply shock. So initially the cars cannot go out, then trucks, and then of course the airlines, we ship, we actually do a large B2B business. We provide gasoline for trains and planes, among others in the industry. So all of them have come to a halt. So we have to redo our entire planning for the year and even leading towards next year because of what has happened. In the Philippines, we're seeing already that the food and beverage is almost half of the normal consumer consumption. So out of a 14 trillion peso, so ours is one is to 50, $1 is to 50 peso, so 13.9 trillion peso. The food and beverage is a significant chunk, but those who were our business lies, we have very high risk across what we call the miscellaneous goods and services, the transport, restaurants and hotels, furnishing, communication, recreation, and cultural, alcoholic, and clothing and footwear. If you look at a lot of the major impacts, actually, discretionary spend segments would be on restaurant and hotels, recreation and culture. So which means people would actually have less disposable income. They would just be spending on what would be necessary, you know, the necessities. So the so that would be one of the challenges for a lot of the industries. For restaurants, clothing and footwear, retail outlets, transport, communication would all feel the dip there. So there's a what they call a three-step roadmap to mitigate the COVID-19 impact. The first, the step one is actually tackle the immediate priorities. So most of us actually have experienced this already. We're done with this. So the first thing, I'm sure, if you look back and reflect what we've done in some bits and pieces, we actually had our checklist, a control tower, we had a war room. But most importantly, we want our business continuity to ensure that our business is continuing regardless of what is happening. So we mobilized our people. We had a lot of meetings with them just so we can still operate during this quarantine. Step two is where most of us are, I would think, preparing for the rebound and seeking advantage in adversity. So most of us would be re-strategizing our 2020 to 2021 and building scenario-based plans. Three key things that we need to remember: fortify our liquidity and profitability, which is the most important thing, manage our cash position and rationalize our cost structure. The second is to ensure that our supply chain will still be there. And the third would be seizing demand recovery. So protecting our customer base and maintaining or growing our wallet share. So especially for most of us, if operations are ongoing, we want to make sure that we're still communicating with the customer. But the bottom pillar, the most important, is always accelerating digital implementation. So we want to redefine our sales, service, and fulfillment to our customer and using a remote working model. As this eventually would come to an end, we have to plan for a new reality post-crisis, so beyond 3 to 6 months. So my prediction is that in the Burr months, hopefully, it would be the new normal coming in. We have to reinvent ourselves, our companies, our organizations. How do we win in the new reality? Reimagine what are the next business possibilities. And I'll share this a bit more in detail later on. I'll show you some Nielsen updates. And what are the new white spaces we can consider? And also, let's restructure. How do we build resilience and crisis planning for future shocks? So here, this is an example of a grocery company in China. What they did when they followed the three phases. So of course, the first is that they actually all underwent hysteria. So from a consumer perspective, there was a panic stockpiling of durables and health items. No? But eventually, people adjusted. There was an initial spike. So for the company, what is important is to build trust and ensure availability. You should have more drops on core items, the more important items. If people are panic buying, I think one should also consider looking at the limiting purchase on selected items and continue to invest in delivery capacity, especially for those that who cannot go out like the elderly. The second would be restriction and adaption. This will be the short term. So most of us are here. So most likely there will be a lot of restrictions on movements, dining out and gathering. There will still be a residual fear of COVID. So again, people will not be going out into their restaurants. So what we need to do, we have to adjust space to the new demand mix, continue to ensure supply and target promotions and leverage quality. So if we know that there are some items that are more faster in terms of selling, then let's focus on that. So we have to change the mix of our products in our store. And then the new normal, which is the Burr months, if we're looking at September, October, November, then again, we're looking at how consumers are adapting to the new behaviors, and there will be a long-term shift to omnichannel delivery, accelerated by 24 months, which means that in many cases, I am sure most of us would have like a digital plan moving forward for 2 years down the line. That is thrown out the window. We have to execute that today already. So purchase of in-home gaming and dining goods would remain to be elevated. What we need to do, understand what are the new trends, invest in accelerating e-commerce capabilities, accelerate focus on prepared foods and pilot stores to testing new concepts. So the question I ask for with some of you here, whether you are an entrepreneur or in corporate, Have you adjusted your space to the new demand mix, or have you seen already any spike in demand across your customers? And how much have you adjusted in terms of planning? You know? And also, are you planning 2 months down the line? What are the new trends? And I'll share with you. I'll share with you later on some of the trends we're seeing already. And how have you invested in accelerating your e-commerce capabilities? One of our audit groups actually presented what they call a resilience wheel. And this is in perspective of actually the SMEs here. They're saying that liquidity is key. And you have to assess your cash on hand and credit you can draw from. In many cases, you have to have a 12-week cash flow forecast to be updated rigorously. And the response should rely heavily on this, which means that they're saying no more planning. You don't even have to plan from a business perspective. You plan based on cash. So you have to look at how much cash you would have 12 weeks down the line and even 6 months down the line, and you plan based on that. So if people are saying that cash is king, it's not anymore. It's cash is God in their terms, because it will now dictate everything, all your business movements. So here are some of the, in many cases, most of us would have issues on cash. I would suggest that these are some of the strategies where you can get cash. So stretch your supplier payments, talk to your banks and landlords if you can defer any payments, sweep idle cash from other facilities. If you have cash from other branches, stations, try to get them into your hands. Negotiate with customers if you can pay. I've seen a lot of travel agencies and hotels saying that you book your room right now at 50% off and you can use it anytime for the next 12 months. So try to get cash early from customers and offer discounts. Of course, work with your insurance and government if there's any relief available. Then there are some of the areas impacting short-term cash flow. So again, the decisions in these areas may impact your cash flow immediately. So look at your workforce availability. How will your operating model need to change if your workforce is reduced? Look at also the fall in demand and also your supply chain issues. I remember I was in a boardroom meeting with a client who's a rice supplier. So it's refine rice and they sell rice. So I was telling them they must have been making a killing in this market where people are now hoarding rice. But what they're saying is that they were supposed to, but they were not prepared. So there was no issue with rice, but there was an issue with their packaging. So a lot of their packaging came from China, and because it was halted in the customs, it was not allowed in. They have a lot of rice, but they don't have the packaging. So if you look at your supply chain, you have to look at your entire product line and also the auxiliary parts of parts of the product offering. So it doesn't mean, for example, in that example, rice, you have a lot of rice, but you don't have packaging, so you can't get that into the market also. So also consider the shift in the strategy. I would suggest you have to, you do not plan for if things go back to normal, because we all know it won't. So there will be a shift in strategy. It might be good for you to discuss with your shareholders right now, with your board of directors, what was the shift in our strategy? What are the potential cash shortages? No? If you will have any breaches and cash shortfalls, how will you augment that? And then again, cash control. So if you look at the Board of Innovation, some of you may have been involved with them. I was speaking to them 2 weeks ago, so they're based in Europe. We're trying to customize something for Asia, but all in all, we're seeing already how industry characteristics, I was taking one from them, where they're looking at the new characteristics of industry given COVID. So they're analyzing industries, not from a consumer side, but really just very anchored on COVID scenarios. So for example, they're looking at the impact based on the large gatherings essential, is close human interaction essential, is there hygiene or perception thereof is critical, is it dependent on travel, is the service or product postponable or expendable. So tourism and hospitality and sports, if you're watching soccer or basketball or any team sports, it's very high impact. So the impact analysis is very high. They will be very much affected. What is also interesting in this chart is actually the automotive industry, where the service or product is postponable. We're seeing already in some of the FGDs where people are saying that they're planning to buy a car this year, but they're now postponing to next year, because they would like to hold on to their money first. So that's one scenario that is happening. That's why they're also impacted with regard to purchase of automobiles. The rest are so-so, beverage, retail, pharma. If you look at adapting a strategic response, most of us are already looking at the U-curve. Remember earlier I talked about the economic contractions, no? The V, the U, and the L. So we're looking at the U. They also look at the impact to organization. So the first things first, label where you are. Are you in the positive? So mostly online business would be here. Are you in like consumer goods? So mildly negative, your sustained revenue loss of 0 to 15%. Severe would be 15 to 50%. This might be oil and gas, and tourism would be catastrophic. So in this example, if there is, for example, a V-curve with some of the countries, those who were able to manage COVID, then you will have a V-curve, you have a rebound immediately. So what would happen is that if you're in this category of positive, you just right away boost supply to keep up with the demand surge. If you're here in the consumer goods category, you just push through and prepare to a fast back to normal upswing. If you're in, like for example, like us, oil and gas severe, just survive and prepare for a relatively slow back to normal recovery. If you're in catastrophic, then maybe you mothball a large part of your business and prepare to restart. Mothball meaning just a mothball, like put everything in the attic, do not mind it for some time and wait for it to come back, right? So you can't do anything here. And hopefully after 6 months, you can restart. Here is the U-curve, so it's a 1.5 year impact. So most of us are here. If you are in e-commerce, push for growth and market share. If you're in retail, in consumer goods, so you defend, improve your competitive position and find new areas of growth. If you're in the severe category, you pivot through organic innovation or inorganic growth, which means you have to look at the new customers. So organic innovation means innovate using your current product offering. What other innovation you can offer to your customers, and in organic growth, meaning you look outside your current offering and offer that to the same line of customers, or you will divest here. No? So same here with severe and catastrophic. Of course, no one is hoping for an L curve, but if this happens, again, hopefully not, for positive industries, just push for market share. If you're in the mildly negative, you just find new areas for growth, defend, improve your competitive position. If it's you're in this severe category, you have to prepare for new entrants and reinvent and create totally new position or abandon. So, for example, in our oil and gas category, you have to look at either aggressive entrants would be coming in, or because they would do not have our baggage. And they will just be very aggressive coming in. If you're in this category, then you will just have to abandon the market. So a lot of we have to identify first where you are and maybe plan accordingly based on the economic impact with your respective countries. But I would suggest all of us would be in this U-curve. Now, how do pandemics end? Maybe there are three key things. Well, first is if the virus mutates and it's no longer deadly, then the pandemic would end. The second is the most likely scenario for us. A vaccine is developed, but however, there won't be a full return to normal until a highly effective vaccine has been discovered, tested, manufactured, and made available to billions. So this would be a year away. So this would be next year. So, and it would not help those already infected. So, however, a lot of the pharma companies I'm seeing already posting that they already have found a cure. So let's see. But I think the next quarter, a lot of the pharma companies will be launching their own cure. So hopefully this would actually manage how people would be scared when going out. We as business people, we have to hope for the future, but also we have to act on the reality of today, right? So again, let's be optimistic, but we need to act on reality because our business has to be anchored on reality. For me, a lot of the SMEs are asking me, so what do I do? What do I do? So I actually created what is called a balance scorecard. If you're an entrepreneur, finance, maybe this could serve as your checklist. So just make sure that summarizing everything that I've said, survive your 12 weeks OPEX, stretch your supplier payments, talk to them already, do not avoid them. If you can stretch, get alternative revenues. So you cannot survive by just doing nothing. Find already alternative sources of revenue or new platforms. And then if you have underperforming assets, sell them already, right? Even at discount because cash is more important so that you can survive the 12 weeks of operations. For people, yeah, assist and reallocate them. So help your people, give them, in the Philippines, you have 13-month pay. So most of them, we gave them already their 13-month pay. We converted some of their vacation leaves. If you do not have money, at least give them actually some food. No? So there are some of our businesses where we just gave them canned goods, rice, and just to make sure their families afloat, even if we cannot hire them, given the low demand. It's also a good time to retrain and train staff. So if you have some staff who, I'm sure most of us in the normal course of business, there's no time for training. Now is the best time, especially for maybe our internal support group like finance, HR. So it's a good time maybe to give them training. And then the management and board might also maybe a good time to revisit the vision and business model. Last year was very busy for all of us. I've seen so many just run through their planning sessions instead of 1 week. Usually we do 1 week planning sessions. It's 1 day and just get it over with so that we can push through with business. So I think maybe a good time to going back to the board, to your partners and discussing the future. I mean, all of you have time, right? So please discuss that seriously. Operations, make sure that your supply is there, continuous flow of supply. Repurpose your business to new business delivery. So I'm sure most of you would be delivering into the delivery or curbside delivery. Start experimenting with that already. Establish new delivery partners if you have Grab or Lala Move here or wherever. I'm sure a lot of new enterprising businesses have gone into logistics, B2C logistics, so partner with them already. And finally, for your customers, communicate and reassure them that you are there and you are there to provide them whatever products that you continue to offer to them. Provide new business delivery method that if they cannot go to the store to buy, you can actually deliver it to them. Deliver them and you iterate to perfection. So this is what I call a new COVID-19 balance scorecard, where hopefully by doing all of this, you'll be able to identify new operational efficiencies. When you look at your finance and operations, new operational efficiencies. When you look at your people and customers, hopefully you may be able to create new ways of working for your people to deliver to your customers in a different way, how you fulfill that customer need. And hopefully if you look at your operations and your customers, maybe you can end up with a new business model. So this might not be too much of a bad scenario because it allows us to actually make some steps, so even 5 steps backward, in order to plan for 10 steps forward. Maybe we can come up with a new business model. I will just run this through very quickly. I will share the slides with you, but this was shared to me by the general manager of Nielsen here in the Philippines. And what they're saying is that some of the trends that we're working on right now, we're looking at China. So I'll just go through this very quickly. This is a study on consumers and also on retailers. So this is a quote by Justin Sargent, who's the president of Nielsen China. He said, as China returns to a new normal, there are sweeping learnings from their experience. It has been a very challenging time. Consumer habits have changed and manufacturers and retailers are looking ahead to turn the crisis into an opportunity. So meet the new customer or the new consumer. They have heightened health awareness. Their focus on quality and safety assurance. There's a new renewed desire to stay at home. They're less loyal and more experimental, and there are tighter budgets for the masses. So again, very quickly, heightened health awareness. After the quarantine, there's an increase in 60% on regular medical checkups, 75% more exercising, 53% more on healthy products on the shelf, eating healthy, buying insurance. So there's now a demand for health or wellness products, fresher and healthier alternatives, more shelf space for healthy products. So again, look at health. How can you pivot your product offering, service offering to the health sector, right? Or a health product. Second is on the quality and safety focus. So again, we're seeing people are now becoming, the brand is very important in terms of delivering quality. So I think, for example, we're seeing a lot of alcohols, for example, they're being sold. They're actually running out of stocks, but the generic ones are actually still on the shelf because people are willing to pay a bigger value if they know the brand. The third is that there's a renewed desire to stay at home. So we're seeing already across different Asian countries that people, after staying at home for some time, they realize, wait, it's not that bad. So they're also fearful of going out, going to coffee shops, going into restaurants for meetings. So they're doing Zoom meetings. They're doing, everything is now operational. They've learned already to become operational at home. So there's a renewed desire to stay at home. And that is why if you look at it, people are shifting from basket to cart. from one to many, from small to big. The implications is that shoppers will likely buy more per trip. We want to promote to encourage upsize or multi-packs. And most of them, we want to spend less time, they want to spend less time in store. So the essential items must be at key locations in store and have higher visibility. So we have to also change our packaging. Fourth is that they will be less loyal and more experimental in a way that if you are out of stock, people are willing to change and shift to the second best. So now if you are a second or third brand, then you can actually fight it off. And if you are reaching, if you're in a category where it's a 1-2-3 fight between you and a market leader, you can actually create and become a market leader if you are more innovative, more experimental, you are more reachable to your customer. Because right now people are now more experimental. And finally, there's a tighter budgets for the masses, which means most of the disposable income for the masses will have gone down. They would be living by the day. So we will see more sachet, more smaller packs that we can sell because they would just be earning by the day. So implications would be more aggressive brand promotions, and we have to review the price sensitivities and the threshold of our product. So that is the consumer. And the retail, four things: better e-commerce adoption, continued rise of neighborhood stores, stronger retailer, supplier partnerships, and technology catalysts. So we're seeing that the FMCG has risen in terms of e-commerce sales. Older shoppers are trying e-commerce, and actually they're becoming very comfortable buying online already. If you look at the purchases, 45% up fashion, home and personal care, beauty, food and non-alcoholic beverages, baby and personal care, infant milk, online food delivery, everything has actually gone up. Neighborhood stores are continuing to thrive. In the Philippines specifically, we're actually, if you look at it, we're actually by barangays, by cities. So we're seeing people not going intercity anymore. And that's why, if you look at that, and also they're not going to the big supermarket chains because of fear. So the groceries, the Alpha Marts, these are the smaller groceries, have very high increase. So there would be continued patronage of neighborhood stores and more frequent trips to nearby store. So the entrepreneur will now have a good fighting chance of fighting it out with the big ones because of their accessibility. There is also an expectation for stronger retailer-supplier partnerships. So in many cases, if you're a supplier, you have to work with the retailer more, partnering and planning with them, identifying what are the top SKUs, how do you optimize your assortment, how do you do stocking and inventory management, and how do you work together in building shopper understanding and insights. And the fourth one would be the technology catalyst is now driving behavioral change. So we're seeing already most of us, even those who wouldn't know or who doesn't know how to do online payments, online transfer, people are now becoming online, digital savvy already. We're seeing also that Viber communities, Facebook Messenger groups have abound and are selling different wares. A lot of the cloud kitchens have come up and people, because they don't have income or sometimes they're just bored at home, so they're cooking, they're offering their products to anyone who wants it. And of course, live selling, again, has become very popular. We've seen how China's done it and it's also happening across different Asian groups. So I won't go through this. But so now let's preparing for the new normal. In summary, is to embrace the changes. The new consumer is all about having a heightened health awareness, focus on quality and safety. There's a renewed desire to stay at home. They're less loyal, more experimental, and there will be tighter budgets for the masses. And again, the new retail, better e-commerce adoption already, be on e-commerce if you can. There will be a continuous rise of neighborhood stores, the mom and pops would be there. There will be a stronger retailer supplier partnerships, and technology would now be very natural rather than before there is a hurdle for people to become tech savvy. Now they are actually very tech savvy. And because of that, all of us, no. My last part, I'll just say that we've seen already how many businesses have learned to pivot, to change their offering. I just got this from an e-newsletter from Marriott. They're already here. If you look at it, who would have thought that Marriott would be selling their beds, pillows, linens, beddings, bath scents? So you cannot. Hotels are actually in the Philippines. Hotels are closed. So here they're even selling everything. No? The Marriott experience doesn't have to be in their hotel anymore. You can actually buy the Marriott experience and now use it in the comforts of your home. In the Philippines, we've seen already If you're familiar with Chicken Joy, if you're familiar with a lot of our restaurants, you would have thought that our number one food chain, you can only, they would never in their lifetime think of providing it from a frozen perspective, their fried chicken. But now their fried chicken is now being offered in all the supermarkets here. Potato Corner, our number one French fries, it's a stall, but they would never give their frozen fries to anyone because it's their secret formula and even their seasoning. But now you can actually test and text them and they will deliver frozen fries and you just get to cook it. If you look at a lot of our ramen houses here, if you the practice here is that even if you cannot finish your ramen, you cannot take it home because they're very strict. They don't want you to look at their formulation. Now they're giving everything to you. Take home the ramen. Right? So it's a change, a total change in mindset, total 180 degrees shift in how they look at their business to in order to keep the business going. So for all of you, let me ask you, I think in many cases for all of us, let me end by asking, what did you do during COVID? I'm sure most of us, we have in one time or the other, when we were younger, we ask our grandparents or our parents, what did you do during World War II? When the Japanese invaded and where, what did we do? Where are we, right? Or the British invaded, whatever, right? The World War II. In our lifetime, we experienced COVID and I'm sure our sons and grandkids would be asking us, what did you do during COVID, right? And what is our story, right? So some of you, maybe you can say that you just stayed at home and watched Netflix. There's nothing wrong there, by the way. In the Philippines, the government has just one mandate, stay at home, right? So do not infect others and don't get infected. So you can say that you stayed at home and watched Netflix, nothing's wrong there. Or you can say we help people who are in need, right? Or you can say we repurpose our business to optimize whatever resources you have to provide new services to our customers. Or you can say you created a new business opportunity to help our country. And that is your story to tell, right? And some of you still have time, right? What is your COVID story? From a personal perspective, from a corporate business professional perspective, please start thinking about this because you will be asked this down the line. For me, I'll be honest with you. At night, of course, I have my share of watching Netflix series. I managed to finish a lot of Netflix series already. While working, this is playing, and I get to appreciate also because I'm in the media and entertainment business. This is a bit work also, half work for me. But at the same time, I'm also studying. So we're looking at, because I'm looking at going into the payment business. So I finished a Coursera course. Telehealth is a booming business. So I also finished a Harvard Medical School. So this is May 3. And then I said, you know, I realized I have to review my digital. So it's a Google Digital Garage. I sweep this, but this was a week program. I finished this Google refresher for me. And just recently, I finished my ISO in innovation training across this 60 days of we were under quarantine. So I'm also studying, and I think that's why it's also very good that MIS is offering a lot of these courses. Please take them, because it's already a battle of the minds and how much you know, and how the more you know, actually, the more you can help your business. At the same time, we've also done our share. I've been doing the rounds, helping people, donating. We have Contis, which is our bake shop. So every day we would be producing more bread than normal. And we'll be going out and giving it to our frontliners, to our checkpoints, to our military, to our police. Repurposing our business. So we have Family Mart. We now have Fam on Wheels. We're experimenting also selling our LPG, going around communities selling. We've also provided business for people who would like to sell LPG and water, among others. And we even actually work with our employees who were a bit displaced. They're not doing anything. We said, why don't you set up your own business? And we provide them a lot of products from our Family Mart. And they're now operating their small grocery. So this is something that we gave to the wives or the husbands of our employees, especially those who are in the more depressed areas. And the new business model, something I'm launching soon with a business partner. So we're seeing earlier, I said, it's a... a lot of the residential people have their cloud kitchens, but they're all on Viber, they're not organized. So we're organizing, we're creating an app and a web-based application so that we can actually offer this to the public. It's a service that we're giving to the individuals who are affected by COVID. They're just operating in their kitchen. They don't do a lot of digital marketing. So now they can just sign up with us. And then, of course, it's easier for the consumers. It's easier for them also to sort and also to check what they would like to eat for this period. So it's something we're experimenting, but hopefully it's a service we can give to our community, to the small micro entrepreneurs, and also to the consumers. So that's my COVID story, right? And like what said, it's a bit of everything. Let me end with a video. I like this video a lot. It's the video that Coca-Cola released, no? And it's a reminder for all of us that amidst all of these negative mindsets and scenarios, the human spirit would always, live on and persevere. And it's the mindset that we carry through that would help us as we rebound from this COVID. That's a reminder for all of us that, again, the human spirit will always persevere. And let me end by saying, give me a quote. I start with a quote, I'll end with this quote. Oh, the opportunity lies in where the complaints are. And it's a great reminder from Jack Ma. He would always say, I like people with problems because I earn from solving their problems. And hopefully that's also a mindset we all would have as marketing people, as entrepreneurs, because that's the challenge that is being thrown in our lifetime. Let's take advantage of creating our own story and solving that problem also. So let me end with this hashtag, COVID is forever. We all hope that COVID is not going to be forever, but let's have that mindset because it's not about hoping and wishing that everything would go back to normal. By accepting the fact that COVID is going to be forever, let's prepare ourselves, our business, our spirit, our enterprise to actually adjust already starting today on this new normal. On our consumers have changed. Technology is already out there. Let us have a game plan already, how to adjust so that have this mindset so that we can actually prepare for our future. So with that, thank you for having me. Maybe I'll open the floor for now questions. Thank you.
Hi, Donald. Wow. I should say fantastic presentation today. I think the video really hits me. Really, the human spirit is where really challenges us right now to actually rise beyond ourselves in terms of community, in terms of humanity. So thanks for sharing that video. It really touches our heart. And at the same time, like you, I'm watching Netflix, just to confess, a couple of days back, I started series, which was recommended by a friend in the area of karate. So there was you know, my interest is also in karate. So so there was a TV series from China, from Hong Kong. So it's on View. In View. Okay. I know, Donald, you have about less than 10 minutes with us in terms of Q&A. But seriously, I really want to give you thanks for joining us. You have been a speaker that always wanted to bring to our Singaporean, including our Singaporean business community, you know. And I will be approaching you again if you don't. I think really we all enjoyed today's session. Now, I've got the questions coming in from the public. Sorry, not public. Oh, Andy. Okay, Andy is from a telco. Anyway, for your info. Now, is that a news report? Mentioned that most of telco in the world may benefit from COVID-19 due to higher data consumption. But most telcos are offering big data with low fees right now. So in your opinion, how do we increase customer spending leveraging on data plan purchases? Okay, very technical, very industry focused. Question.
No, actually, if you look at one of the key things moving forward, you have to always remember, all of us, whether we're competitors or not, we have to look at the entire business ecosystem. Consumers remain to be consumers. If you are a restaurant, if you are selling a shampoo or a soap, you have to look at your business partners from an overall perspective, which means telco companies' data. I mean, in the Philippines, we actually bundle our soap with free load for data, with free load for text and call and all of these bundled offerings. So I think there's a big opportunity. We have to just look outside of what we traditionally are doing and again, see this. No? So usually we would have our own partners. So you have you should have, in a sense, a telco partner, a retail partner, a food partner, so that you look at your ecosystem and how you will be able to promote each other. Right. So again, I think that may be a interesting thing. A lot of telcos, you're right, may be earning a lot due to higher bandwidth consumption. But their reality is also a lot of them are also trying to help. They also have higher costs because they have to maintain ITs there. Their OPEX have also gone up. Everything has also gone up to make sure that you deliver the internet bandwidth to all of you.
Yeah, thanks. I hope, Andy, if that answered to your questions. I know he's coming. Anyway, Andy, it's one of the directors from one of the telecommunication in Singapore itself. So that's why when he read your, when we sort of read your accolades, he picked that up. All right. Okay. Donna, I've always realized that in your presentations, it always ends off being very motivated. So I guess, you know, pretty much from your presentation itself, it really gives very clear in terms of clarity on some of the industries that we'll be picking up and some of the industries that really need to transform themselves. All right. And there are a lot of redundancy, looking at redundancy itself. And one of the things that pick up, you know, definitely in economic downturn where cash is really king right now. So this is where look at all your product, your business portfolios and divest those that make sense. Keep those questions coming. So you've got more questions coming and do let us know. Hang on. Okay, I've got a questions from Evelyn Chu, but she placed it on the chat group. Okay. All right, Evelyn, I think, hang on. You're coming in from a guest. Hang on. Let me, it goes on somewhere.
Yeah. Okay. And I saw the question, Roger.
Yeah. Okay. You can ask the questions. Yeah.
So my answer to you, Evelyn, so for example, we're selling gasoline. That the demand has gone down, but what we saw was that there was a massive offtake on our LPG. So that is the home, that the gas that you use for cooking. So our sales there was very tremendous. We even actually on the end, we had more people wanting to franchise our LPG, our liquefied petroleum gas. So, and interesting for you when you ask e-commerce, because when we go to Lazada, you can go to Phoenix LPG. We're actually selling our petroleum gases there. So who would have thought that in Lazada, you will be buying toys and baby products and among many other things. Who would have thought going there to sell and buy a gas tank that you would be using in your home? But the sales are doing very well there also. I think let's have that e-commerce mindset. I cannot speak for your country, but it is always worth experimenting on. Right? So I think when you talk about innovation, it's always try and make a pivot after, right? Try and iterate until you get it right. But always we have to try.
Good. I think that's a good advice. You know, keep trying, keep trying until you get it.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so that's, I think a lot of companies in Singapore are trying everything, you know. Donald, just to let you know, yesterday I picked up from one of the group chat from the events management company itself. Yeah. And when I went in to see what they are doing, they are offering something that's totally out of their previous portfolio. They are doing cleaning right now.
Cleaning,
offering services such as cleaning, sanitization services in terms of office. So I think really it's to transform into something that's being needed right now. We are all humans, you know. Let's not belong to what we used to do, the new norm.
Yes.
So thanks for sharing on the new norm itself. That is something that's very, very interesting. I think we still have about 3 minutes of your time.
No problem.
Okay, if you've got questions, please keep it coming. Otherwise, I'll pick up the next question. Now, if you were asked, or if you are an entrepreneur right now, coming from an events company, I'm asking for myself. Sorry, guys. Okay, I think, Donna, you know, I own an event company for the past 20 years. I also have a digital platform that looks into app. So we are doing a number of apps right now in order for some of the customers, you know, to actually use the apps as a form of engagement or even a direct communication. So where do you see, or what is your advice to an events company that has been going around for 20 years and we do a lot of events where human-to-human interaction is the most critical?
Yes.
What do you think the events industry will transform into?
I think number one, that's a good question. Because if you look at our industry here, we're also very event-centric, especially for the Philippines. Our hotels are always full. And right now, they have zero. I think you're seeing already a migration to online. So it's a race towards who can perfect that online experience. I judge in a global, for example, awards conference called the Grand Guild. And it's like a big, posh conference in Chicago. And right now they're doing the first Grand Guild purely online. The awarding, globally awarding, it's also done online, right? And you will see more and more of these. I think the expectations will be the same in terms of providing the best speakers. For example, I'm with the MAP, Management Association of the Philippines. And that time, I've been with them, I've been organizing their conference for the past 10 years. And before, there's no such, it's so hard. You want to get Jack Ma, you want to get the Prime Minister of England or whoever, it's impossible to get them to fly here for security reasons. Now you can invite them and just have them 1 hour or 45 minutes online, everything becomes possible. So right now, it's all about, again, people will pay for quality. People remain to be people. People need to eat, to consume. People need to learn. So people will always give a premium and a value, and they would be willing to pay as long as that value is met. So I would suggest you can still work on that. For example, one of our concert artists, Gary Valenciano, I don't know if you met him, went online and got 7 million pesos just doing a concert for 2 nights, right? And it was just inspiring a lot of our Filipino citizens. So there is a big opportunity. Your cost will also go down anyway. Your OPEX will go down. So I think it's all about now management and all about how do you, for example, if you have a online conference, how can you earn, like do merchandising, your shirts, your bags, your whatever, you can now start selling that also. Also working in advocacy, so people have a higher likelihood to give money because a percent would always be helping. So the charity, you tack on that charity mindset also of people. they're now more willing to pay rather than just give everything to you. So you get a mix of all of that. And I think there is a, I mean, no one has a crystal ball, but we've seen already some formulas where you can make it, you know, make it work.
Thanks. As you can see, I'm taking a lot of notes. Thanks, Donald. That's good. Okay. Right. Okay. I've got Evelyn Chiu also. Hi, I'm. She has a team building and carnival event company too. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Evelyn, I'll be more than happy to share with you.
Each other. Yeah.
Okay, Donna. One. Okay, we're reaching. Okay, you need to leave for your next session. Really, on behalf of everyone, the whole community out here, I really want to give you a big round of applause and a big mention. Well, Donna, really, I think you are my dream speaker. I've been talking about you for the past 1 year every time. So I really wish to actually invite you on board again in our one of our webinar sessions.
Sure.
Really, thank you for your insight. I think I can safely say that today is one of those best
thank you.
Ever had so far. All right. Really deep from my heart. Thank you, Donald. Donald, yeah. Thank you so much for spending time with us.
Thank you. Take care. To my AMF brothers and sisters, stay healthy.
Okay. Thank you, Donald. Thank you. So there you have it, you know, our lunchtime webinar itself, where we're very, very happy to actually have Donald with us. Now, tomorrow, can I have the slides for tomorrow, please? Okay, tomorrow is where we have Mr. Earl Allens. He'll be touching on the topic of the importance of design thinking post-COVID-19. Ah, this is interesting, yeah? Where everything is going to change, the new norm is going to kick in. So how you actually goes into design thinking, how to actually make sense out of what you have. At least this is what I think you'll be touching on. So Earl Allens is actually one of our top trainers, also from the Marketing Institute of Singapore itself. So do join us tomorrow at 12:30, between 12:30 to 1:30. Probably it stretches beyond 1:30 sometimes, like today. All right, so fantastic, all right. So tomorrow, please join us for Earl Allen's session on the topic of the importance of design thinking. Right, so I'm approaching the closing, so I'll just have to do my little bit. Remember what Dr. Donna has said. See, he picked up a lot of courses. Wow. Amazing guy. Like what I said, I knew him like 1.5 years back. And you see, during this period of time, the very questions that you should ask yourself is, what have you been doing? Have you been watching Korean drama, Netflix, playing online games, or just sleeping at home? Some of my good friends are ordering beer, drinking from home and stuff. It's good that you're doing all this from the comfort of your home, but nevertheless, you should pick up some form of training. Can I have my next slide, please? Okay. So to join us also in our Asia Marketing Day on the 27th of May. Now, here's where you have a lot of top minds talking about post-COVID. What can we be doing post-COVID itself? You have more than 22 speakers on a panel platform, panelist platform itself. So do find out more. Tomorrow we'll be sharing with you the timetable, okay, the outline. All right, so next slide, please. Can I have the next slide? Okay, executive program. Yeah, great, this slide. So like what Dr. Donna said, right, pick up something. Now, I myself, during this real time, I've picked up a couple of, well, I'm always on YouTube, trying to pick up on new knowledge and watching global news, trying to keep myself on track with what is going on. So find out how you can pick up one of our courses. I would highly recommend digital marketing, leadership, because this is where you need in terms of leadership skill, and of course, sales, money, you know, ching ching. So yes. All right, go into personal effectiveness at the same time. Okay, these are some of the courses which I will highly recommend to you. Now, some of the industries that will pick up will be in of course, content creation, copywriting to back content creation itself, videography being one of them, although we are not offering that right now. So, And then service excellence, you know, looking at online service excellence, online platform. If anything that you need to learn more is how to make yourself digitally savvy. Okay, next please. Now, which brings me back to our advanced diploma in digital marketing, I will highly, highly, highly recommend you. Okay, in fact, I know of one of the sales director of one of the telco will be picking that up. So find out more. Okay, it's, I think it costs over 6 months. You probably attend once or twice in a week, and then perhaps and then a couple of weeks to do your project and things like that. So get yourself certified as a digital marketer, okay? All right, besides our diploma in sales and marketing and diploma in business. Join us as our member, like what we said, we're giving it free. So if MIS, if you find that they are not responding to you, right, you can always let me know. Because I think they're pretty busy. Okay, mass donation, like what we said, you see Donald has been doing a lot of his own CSR project, going around giving away free bread. Let's do our very small little part, right? Let's donate masks to Philippines. Okay, right, scan on the QR code. Otherwise, to make it even easier for you, if you want, you can call any of our staff. We have two numbers being flashed on the screen right now. Just donate a box of masks and 50 people will be able to benefit from that. Okay, right. So we've reached the end of today's session, and I really want to thank you for staying on with us. And do join us again tomorrow, same time. Mr. Frankie Chong, you were asking about sending the link. Okay, someone please reach out to Mr. Frankie to send the link for tomorrow's sessions. In fact, you can find tomorrow's sessions link on our Facebook. So log on to the Marketing Institute of Singapore Facebook and find the link for tomorrow's presentation. Otherwise, you can log on to our website. Okay, I hope it's there on our website though. Okay, all right, log on to the same address. Anyway, it'll be the same address every day at around 12:30, and you'll be together with us with our trainers for tomorrow, Mr. Allens. So with that, I will stand down and see you tomorrow. Make more time.